Magandang umaga, magandang tanghali, magandang gabi. Sa sino man nanonood nito, mabuhay kayong lahat. My topic today is actually postcolonial paths to constructing the nation. It was called nation before, but we might want to do bansa, banwa, or even bayan. Let me quote from our very eminent Professor Emeritus, University Professor Emeritus, and a poet, Hemino Abad, because he said, forging our poetry is like a double forgery. What does he mean by that? Our poetry in the 1980s to the present is marked by a very heightened consciousness of language. Very heightened consciousness of language. Let me underline that. In this way, he says, language creates its own reality. And that word reality must be put in quotation marks as well because it's so-called reality. Why? In a way, it's a double forgery. A forgery from language, which itself is already a fiction or a counterfeit of reality, and a forgery to one's own consciousness from the reality outside language. That's Hemino Abad from Scene So Fair. What does he mean by that? First, put in your mind, reality is not equal to what is out there. What is out there is a construction. Meaning, if you look at this, okay, you call it La Mesa. Because we agreed it was going to be, we're using words, La Mesa. But somebody might call it toilet. But anyway. So what does it mean? That reality is already a representation. And therefore a double forgery, because you have language and then you have supposedly language used for poetry reflecting reality, but that reality in itself is already construction. Now I'm talking to everybody, whether you're writers or researchers, NGO, GO, everybody, artists, designers, and then even musicians, broadcast people, performing artists, and then the whole set, architects, anthropologists, sociologists, social scientists, those who are trying to save the environment, or environmentalists, theoretical scientists, and applied scientists. I'm talking to all of you. Why? Because we all use some kind of language. We all use some kind of form. So what does that mean? That you need to have a heightened consciousness of the form or the language that you're using so that you can give it more meaning, so that you can have some kind of meaningfulness. Okay? This is where my postcolonial paths come in. The postcolonial framework that in the 1990s I brought out, to the consternation of my, I call them katitahan, the faculty of my own Department of English and Comparative Literature, who said, we're doing literature, we're not doing politics. But they could not shoo me out because I was their daughter of sorts, academic daughter. What are postcolonial strategies? This includes first a critique of Western, okay, hegemonic, okay, practices, okay, and texts. So all of those are terms. And you know that we have to infuse those terms with some kind of signified, or those of you who know your susur, signifier, signified, okay. And the next part of the postcolonial strategies has to do with an affirmation of marginalized cultural forms. Now, what I'm saying actually is found in this book, a UP Press book now available, may I say something like Amazon? Okay, now available on Amazon.com. It's almost out of print. The first printing came out in 1993, and the last printing was in 2004. It was co-edited by Priscelina Patajo-Legasto and myself. But I put it all together, and this is those essays that I think, please have a chance to read. You can have a chance to read it. These are discourses of worlding, world, forming a world, so worlding, and postcolonial studies. And the other essay is Literatures from the Margins. So please read those so that we can understand what paths to the Bayan I'm talking about. And in 2004, when I brought out the second edition of this, I made sure that I also showed the reaction to my postcolonial paths. Remember, the Department of English is as old as the university, 1908. It's so obvious. Why would the Americans not want to create a Department of English, where most of our professors then, before the war, were Americans anyway, because they knew the value of English, okay? But I was comparative literature. And comparative literature naman was very Frenchified, because for the French, when you say literature, you meant French literature, and all the rest, even British, even American, were called national literature. So what do you do with the others? Then it's called third world. So first, second, third. Oh, wala na. That's what we are. We're always third world to them. That's why later on, Literatures from the Margins talks about getting them back, getting what has been occluded back into our consciousness. I must come and get this guy. He's Raymond Williams, Manchester. You have to define the word practices. In the 20th century, this British materialist emphasis on the word materialist, as opposed to, for instance, something like spiritual. Okay, Raymond Williams talked about cultural forms as products of what? Concrete determinations, concrete factors, material forces. They're called material forces. Okay, and not only material forces, we have to look, meaning politics, economics, literary arts, etc., all of these movements, we must also think in terms of relations, material relations. Remember, he's from Manchester, a red brick, they call it red brick. That's where the Beatles came from. That's where the working class was supposed to have sprung compared to other universities in London. Now, he was also talking about material conditions like, what is your class? What is your race? What is your ethnicity? What is your religion? What is your gender? So all of these are relations, and all of these are concrete material determinations. So I will put there, critique of Western hegemonic. I also underline the word hegemonic, okay? Why? Because hegemonic means being dominant with our consent. Why our consent? Why do we want to be dominated with our consent? Okay, let me see. I wrote that in, you can see my book, it's there on page 8. And then this is where we get the word, why would we be socialized with our own consent? And the one who gave us this word, interpolated, was Louis Althusser. So he was the one who brought a term to our consciousness, like ideological state apparatuses. What does that mean, ISAs? It means the family, the church, the school, the political parties, the academic and professional institutions. In other words, everything around us. And you could go on and on, from literary contests to all the way to academic councils, like, for instance, National Research Council of the Philippines. He's talking about ideological state apparatuses. In contrast to what he also called repressive state apparatuses. Now, why repressive? Because they are all part of the state, meaning from the government to the instrumentalities of that government, like police, like army, navy, including the prisons. These are all repressive state apparatuses. In other words, you comply with what they're saying, otherwise, you're dead meat. Excuse me, you're dead, okay? However, when you talk about the ISAs, you would say, my family is part of my socialization or interpolation process. Are they doing something to me that is bad? My my church, my school? Althusser would say yes. Now, if you're wondering, why am I quoting all of these materials? Actually, this is my syllabus. When I go to class, I have a cup of coffee here, and everything here is my syllabus. What does that mean? It says, I come from a long line of mentors. And let me state my position very clearly. I'm a socialist, Manchester trained by my own people. But let me first say, this is my face, okay? I have a face there. And then on my left is it my left? Yeah, on my left, if you're looking at the cup, is Karl Marx, the German ideologue Karl Marx. On my right would be Eagleton. Then you have Althusser. Then you have below the women. You have Barks, first Roland Barks. Then Linda Hutchin. And then Gayatri Spivak. And then Foucault. And then Catherine Belsey. And then down below are my Philippine, these are my Philippine mentors. Of course, number one would be, to me, one of the greatest socialists and still most believable nowadays is Manchester Train, is Dodong Francisco Nemenso. Dodong Francisco Nemenso, our former president, UP. I was in his cabinet. And then the second one is Randolph David, okay? And of course, the third one is Reynaldo Eletto from history. Randolph David is from sociology, and then Professor Nieves Epistola. She was like my academic mother. She taught me how to care for people, especially students. She taught me how to be very creative in using all of this. And that's the reason why one day I told my dad, I won't go to law in order to memorize the presidential decrees of your classmate. He was class 39, meaning he was the classmate of Marcos. And so I went on, I was first quarter storm, 68 to 72, why am I going to law? So I went to my MA, Comparative Literature, and finally PhD, Philippine Studies, and that's how I developed this post-colonial critique. With all of this, so in a way, I used the ISAs in order to form myself as the person I am now. The other person that I need to talk to you about is Antonio Gramsci. He gave us the word hegemony. Hegemony means domination or subjugation with the consent of the dominated or subjugated. So why should we be subjugated? If we use Althusser, you would say, it is because we are using all of these, and all of these ISAs, we are being subjected by all of these ISAs, and we think that all of these that come to us are natural, or the way things are, or should be, God-given, or universally accepted as truth. We now know there's no such thing as natural. Natural, that's why we should put it in quotes. What's natural? Is it natural for a woman to stay at home? Is it God-given for, I'm always talking about women, is it God-given that our very hardy men have to go and be OFWs abroad? Is that God-given because we are poor or universally accepted as the truth? The truth is what? That the third world countries have always been number three in almost everything, whether you're talking about economics, or politics, or Catholicism. No. Antonio Gramsci was the one who taught us hegemony with consent is what we should fight against. There, hegemonic. And Foucault gave us another term. He calls it discourses. Discourse has to do with modes of knowledge that, okay, are related to relations of power. For instance, the discourse on medicine. I'm not going to have an albulario heal me, although I'm in pain. In fact, I did have an albulario heal me. Why? Because Western medicine says, no, you use the pharmacy. You use pills. Okay? The discourse on religion. It will tell me go to church every Sunday because I am part of the dominant Catholic ideology. Fortunately for me, the Jesuits took over my education. When I was in St. Mary's College, the Jesuits were the ones who trained the religious of the Virgin Mary. Therefore, to me, when I went to UP, I started to think in terms of theology of liberation. Now, that one is not related to power, because otherwise people will say, no, you just go to church, you pray the rosary, then you go to confession, then that's it. Then you go during holidays of obligation, that's it. That's the discourse on Western religion. The other one is discourse on patriarchy. Okay. Oh God, that's the one that says that women should stay at home. Men are the superior group of creatures. The discourse on music will say, you should know the symphonies. I was, in fact, growing up with my dad trying to interpolate me with classical music. What does that mean? Oh, I know my Brahms, I know my Beethoven, I know my Chopin. But he did not allow me to watch Tagalog movies. So I'm only discovering Tagalog movies now, and I'm only discovering, what's his name? Coco Martin. All of a sudden I realized, oh, I like Coco Martin. I like his, what's that? That show where he is a cop. Oh, I said, I like that Coco Martin, but at the same time, I know how good it is as a propaganda appropriation. Because now you look at the police and our nerves don't go up like that. Before, when I used to see police, military, I'd like to bust their heads. Sorry. I'm not a violent person, but I would have liked to bust their heads. Pero Coco Martin, I would like to have a selfie with you. Oh, yan. Yan ang discourse on the military now has changed. Discourse means modes of knowledge. We must be always aware about what these discourses coming from television, coming from the movies, coming from books, all of this, what are they telling us? A postcolonial perspective, I said also, critiques how non-Western and Filipinos, non-Westerners or Filipinos have been and continue to be constructed. You see the word constructed, meaning ginagawa, it's being made, or represented as Europe or Britain or America's ontological other. What does that mean, ontological other? In other words, there is no essential me. There's no essential self. So to be America or Europe, America's or Britain's or Europe's other means that we are their opposite, what Westerners are not, through their cultural practices and texts, okay? But there's no essential like that. So if you accept that, that means you have been hegemonically predisposed to accept it. But that's what we should fight. And this is how Jacques Lacan comes into the picture. He has a theory that talks about how we become subjects. Remember, if you're subjects, you're here. Because there are rulers and you become subject, right? So he says, how have we been made to accept supposed truths that our culture and people were inferior to or less developed compared to the cultures and peoples of Europe, Britain, and the United States? Well, remember man in French is homme, silent H. So he has this theory of subject construction. The baby, when it's born, it's like an omelette. So it's a play on the word omelette, the eggs, with no sense of identity, is spreading in all directions. Then the child goes through what is called a mirror phase when he acquires an imaginary self. You will ask, why imaginary self? He is actually not the freely thinking and freely acting individual that liberal humanist ideology makes him believe he is. Instead, he has become the subject of liberal humanist ideology. So look, when you're in the West, especially, well, that has been there for such a long time, we question it only after we were liberated supposedly from the Americans. It means that the child, as she is acquiring language, is beginning to think that, oh, I am becoming a very good member of this community. That's why it's imaginary. Because in fact, he's taught, let's say, boy, the meaning of boy. He's taught free, the meaning of what it means to be free. I am free, I am a boy, I am tall, I am guapo, or I have looks. It goes on and on until he enters the symbolic order according to Lacan, which is the society. Now what happens to him? He becomes the full subject of the humanist ideology. But we're saying that it's not true because he is not freely acting and he is not freely thinking. So these are among the things that we should look at. What is the canon that is thought of to be universal? The Western canon. Aristotle was talking about, in his poetics, Greco-Roman literature. These are the Greco-Roman literatures like Iliad, Odyssey, supposedly by Homer, and then you have Oedipus Rex by Aeschylus. You have Medea by Euripides and Aeneid by Virgil. So those of us who go through college and are made to look at the masterpieces will necessarily think that this is it. But you know, Aristotle in his poetics actually was describing this everything here. But he was not saying this is it. It was only after that we made it part of the canon, we thought that this is the best literature and we should all follow that. That's why we now call the study of aesthetics poetics, based on our adherence to Aristotle. Then of course there is Shakespeare. I mean, nobody will say, no, I don't know Shakespeare, especially his plays and his sonnets like Hamlet, Macbeth, Romeo and Juliet, Midsummer Night's Dream, Much Ado About Nothing. Who in his right mind will say, before, huh? I don't know Shakespeare. They'll say, oh dear, why are you in the university? You should have even learned about him when you were in K-12, so high school. Okay. They forget to the context of Shakespeare. Shakespeare was a man of the masses. He was giving his plays, of course, to the masses. The only thing that, under the determination we should look at is, how will you perform and how will your troupe perform in front of the masses if you have no money? That's why there was the reality of having a donor or a patron, and his patron was Elizabeth, Queen Elizabeth. But we looked at some determinations, say, kaya pala, he's really good, so we should really study him as if this was it. If you're talking about comedy, this is it. If you're talking about tragedy, this is it. If you're talking about poetry, this is it. Now let's look. So those are the so-called canon. Now let's look at something which we should really critique, and it has to do with negative representations of the Congolese in the Congo during the 19th to early 20th centuries. Now some of us really read Joseph Conrad and The Heart of Darkness, not realizing that there are so many racial slurs here. And if you were to look at many of the lines there, they're coming from the racism that used to infect European writers. Now, if you have you have Heart of Darkness, look at the racial slurs from the narrator character who is European. His name is Marlowe. And I'm quoting Marlowe, Heart of Darkness. Remember that Western culture is developmentalist, meaning its view is that you start from almost nothing, nature, then you go all the way up to Greco-Roman, feudal, industrial revolution, and then you go forward to space age. So, where is the Congolese state? Here is what they're saying. Going up the river was like traveling back to the earliest beginning of the world. So that means that, unlike now, we say, oh, ganda, nature, it's beautiful, nature. No, for the Westerners, it means you're going back to being primitive. It's animal-like, precisely. Now and then, a boat from the shore, okay, gave one momentary contact with reality. And look at this. It was paddled by black fellows, emphasis on the black. You could see from afar the white of their eyeballs gleaming. Ano yan? You're talking like a tiger? You can see the eyes gleaming? You could see from afar the white eyeballs gleaming. And then they shouted, they sang, their bodies streamed with perspiration. What does that mean? It's all, it's all body and sweat. Whereas the Westerner, even if he's there in supposedly Congolese land, he will be dressed. What else did they do? They showed they had faces like grotesque masks. Awala na si ano. They don't look like, who are their gods? Poseidon? Or even Achilles? No. Grotesque masks, muscle, a wild vitality. So all of these words in Heart of Darkness are actually racial slurs. So we have to critique those. And anything we find, even if it belongs to one of our books, we should be wary of perpetuating the same kind of racism that the Westerners brought here. And the word for that kind of racism was given to us by Edward Said, again, from the West. Remember, these are guys who critique their own societies because they knew they were being unfair to the rest of the world. So the critique of Orientalism is actually a critique of negative stereotypes of the Orient. Edward Said is the guy who gave us the word Orientalism. Orient is the key term. The other one is Occident. We used to have courses like Occidental Literature, Oriental Literature. So even in our department before, we used to have a divide. You know? We used to have First World Literature, Second World Literature, Third World Literature. We were perpetuating those kinds of things. So Edward Said, in his book, Orientalism, gave us a critique of that, 1979. And he said, the French and the British, less so the Germans, the French and the British, less so the Germans, the Russians, the Spanish, the Portuguese, all of these were in some way perpetuating Orientalism. A way of coming to terms with the Orient that is based on the Orient's special place, supposedly, in the Western experience. But in spite of that Western special relations with us, we now know that the Orient is not only adjacent to Europe, it is also the place of Europe's greatest and richest and oldest colonies. Remember, in this part of the world, you have India, you have China, you have Southeast Asian countries. And most of us were what do you call that? Sources of all the riches that the West did not have. Okay? In fact, there's a story about how the Westerners got our coffee. Okay? The Orient is, something that we want to be conscious about, never use the word Orient. A mode of discourse or a form of knowledge by which Europeans and British societies were able to manage, that means to control or even produce the Orient. Produce the Orient. In other words, this is again a construction. Because the Orient is actually Europe's cultural contestant. They had to prove that they were better than China, they were better than India, and they were better than the rest of Asia. This is from Said. Orientalism, or a style of thought based on ontological and epistemological distinctions between the Orient and the Occident. And a very large mass of writers, among who are poets, novelists, philosophers, etc., accepted this distinction between East and West, that is in Said. Now, like what? What distinctions do they make? They have all of these stereotypes about, I'm going to do kawemenan first, women first. I'm sure the guys now, if they still have Orientalist mentalities, will see this, the representations of women from the Near and Middle East. these are belly dancers, exotic and mysterious. The Chinese women are supposedly sensual and malleable. The Japanese women are passive and servile. The Filipinas are smiley, sweet, and servile, and that is actually an Amor Solo painting. So even our own national artists, at one point in time, were doing Orientalist representations of women. So there they are. But we should critique, you know what it's called? These kinds of representations of women. The term was given to us, phallogocentrism, phallus, logocentrism. What does that mean? The phallus, not the biological penis, but the phallus is the male signifier of power. And logocentrism means the ideology of binaries. Let's look at that. Logocentrism was given to us by, here we go, Jacques Derrida. Now, if you're going to fall asleep on me, that's fine. But go on, because this is getting to be something tougher, but something we should really try to learn. Logocentrism, that is Western, it means that you think in terms of twos, binaries, presence versus absence, speech versus writing, reason versus emotion, culture versus nature, man versus woman, self versus other. All of those that I mentioned first are valued. Presence, speech, reason, culture, man, and self. Opposite, these are negative. Absence, writing, emotion, nature, woman, other. That was given to us by Jacques Derrida. So that is Western logocentrism. What is the meaning of it? That means you are not, the at the bottom is, you are not a person if you are not male, if you are not cultured, if you don't have reason, if you are not dealing with people face to face, if you are not there. Okay, that is the meaning of all of this logocentric Westerner. Now, the Westerners were not only thinking in terms of women, they were also thinking in terms of the men, who they thought were sinister, criminal, violent. I didn't make this up. I was able to get a piece of an advertisement, the blood of Manchu, the blood of Manchu. So there's this Chinese guy with his hat on and his Chinese costumes and his long mustache. And he is represented as sinister, criminal, and Manchu. This one, there's another representation. He can be young and full-bodied, very sensual and physical, and the object of all, especially white women. So white women are supposed to be protected from this kind of male. The dark, especially black, but sensual. What do you call that? Okay, the guys know what it is. And this is, I think, the worst. When this is, I have a picture of a 30-year-old person from Zambia, male, who is described as being sick of AIDS and being exported meaning exiled from Africa and sent out into the world. Now this guy supposedly has AIDS, so the advertisement after his name, the ad after his name is, this Mombrilis, in fact, is an AIDS terrorist. And he is worse than somebody who is a suicide bomber. So apart from that, he is represented, apart from being represented as dangerous, he's supposed to be lusting after white women, and he's supposed to have primitive urges. So this is what the Westerners think of us, and this is Orientalism. That is the Orientalist. Those are Orientalist representations that we should really actively try to critique. Okay, Josephine Barrios LeBlanc wrote about the Manungs, or our field workers and fisher folk, the first OFWs that went to California. So he shows the kinds of the lives they led, the fact that they had to go there in order to be able to sustain their families in the Bayan or Filipinas. Now the other post-colonial strategy I said, apart from critique, you have affirmation of newly constructed identities and cultural practices. And the emphasis is on newly constructed identities. Remember, we were all destroyed. We were the other. So there is no essential us. So we have to construct our identities from the deformed identities that they had given us. And the other one is our cultural practices, all our practices. Reconstruct our fragmented identities and affirm our hitherto marginalized cultural practices in order to create new identities and modes of existence outside, modes of existence outside the universalizing, hegemonizing, Eurocentric, British-centric, and American-centric perspectives. Oh my God, that's so much work ahead. Can you imagine? I do not mean that we should deny hamburger, but you know more or less that we appropriated hamburger and made it even better. That's why, excuse me for the advertisement, that's why Jollibee works everywhere, including London, because the ordinary meat was replaced by all kinds of things that made it better. It's the same thing with like our adobo. Adobo is not ours, but we made it and appropriated it as our own. And that's one of our best dishes now. So we do our cultural practices outside the universalizing and hegemonizing Eurocentric, British-centric, and American-centric practices. Okay? What is our agenda? Through our work as writers, critics, cultural activists, everybody, all the way up to environmentalists, we should aim to make whole our fractured identities. Okay? Another word I want to give you is eccentric groups. What are these eccentric? Eccentric means outside the center, because the center is the metropoli, outside USA, outside UK, outside Western, outside mainstream Philippine society as well. So if you're Tibuli, if you're Tausu, if you're Ilocano, you're outside the Philippine National Capital Region. That's eccentric. Ma-eccentric, E-X. Not easy, but E-X and outside the center, centric. Marginalized, minoritized, or even powerless. So what are these? These are the works of the working class, the religious sector, the Muslims like the Tausugs of Sulu, the Maranaos of Lanao, the Maguindanaos of Lake Cebu, and then you have the ethnic groups like the Ifugaos, the Ibanags, the Etas, the Tebulis. Remember, we have 100 languages. That means you have 100 at least ethno-linguistic groups. And then, of course, let me also say that there are the students and the women's sector, and then the children. So these are your marginalized, eccentric groups. And then let me add the gays, the G4M, the lesbians, the bisexuals, and the transvestites. We have to let them all come out with expressions of what it is to be where they are, so that we can have some kind of dialogue and we can start talking about the nation. There are so many things we can do in terms of practices, like for instance, the rituals of the mad men, or the taong putik ng Aliaga Nueva Ecija, the fluvial parades of Peña Francia, the fiestas with the Angono Gigantes, literature in the chapbooks, not just books, but in the chapbooks, literature on blogs, like on Facebook. There is a Facebook poetry. There is a Facebook that's full of poetry of different kinds of Philippine prose, Philippine forms. Then there's broadcast media. There's i-UPTV through smartphones, through tablets. Everything becomes a source of what we can affirm. And not only a source of what we can affirm, but a source for producing also more of what we should be producing as a nation. Art through the metro, LRT, MRT. Installation art. Bands like Dong Abao or Viano. So if you're talking about post-colonial strategies, the second strategy is supposed to be looking for alternatives. And one alternative we should be looking for are alternative histories of eccentric groups. Eccentric meaning outside the mark, outside the center. So one such book is Passion and Revolution by Reynaldo Oleto, the guy on the left. And what he did was he studied the history of the revolution from the point of view of the so-called millenarians. Millenarians or cop groups, parang sira utak, but in fact they were not, they were our own people. Now, Basilio Malolos is another history book that we should look at, but this is in the form of dance when it was presented. But the book is there by Nicanor Chongson, and he talks about the women of Malolos because Jose Rizal talked to them. And then there you have all of those books that actually talk about the nun, the counter histories, counter literature, counter everything, because they were actually counter memories. They came from the groups outside the national capital region, although they were not called national capital region at the time. So you have Pangasinan, Leyte, Cebu, etc. And I myself did as an MA thesis. I discovered that because of my teacher, Damiana Eugenio, she said, no, you're not, don't do anything on Manila, do something about your province. So I did something about my lolo uncle, Pablo Mejia. Turns out, he was the most popular Sarswelista in Pangasinan during the turn of the century. And what he did was that he created the Olop Mejia, which was based in Dagupan. The nice thing to understand about Pablo Mejia's group was that he understood that there were two things that the Sarswelas had to do. First, they had to make sure that the Sarswelas were anti-Spanish. Resentment against the Spanish was something that people understood. But the second thing he wanted was that they had to have a damayan, ala Rey Leto. They had to understand each other as a community. They had to sympathize with people outside their small banwa and think in terms of the entire archipelago, and that was harder to do. So let's see what the others did. The others, like Igmanigpi, they're from Pampanga. What they tried to do also was to give their own version of what happened to them during the time that Pablo Mejia was also doing his Sarswelas. But of course, this is a modern group. The other was Walang Sugat. Walang Sugat, at that time, was a movie. And of course, none of us saw it. But the point was that it kept on coming and reappearing in different forms. Now, this time, it appeared, let's say at the other one, as a show now, a current show, sometime in the 1990s there. And then now you have women OFWs. Soledad Sister is something that is very important in terms of our learning what a counter-narrative could be. It was done by Jose Dalisay Jr., one of our multi-awarded artists, who talked about Soledad, an OFW, or Soledad Sister. The point of the novel is this. It starts with a casket arriving at the airport, and there is a sister that is awaiting the sister of. So we don't know who is the one that died. Was it the sister or Soledad? The point of Jose de Lizal is that you are used to having an intelligent narrator, meaning as long as you follow him or her, you will know what's happening. The point is that that is a Western realist form. He starts with nothing, no intelligent narrator, and then it is about an OFW. Now, the OFW is accompanied by a policeman who tries to figure out what's happening, who killed Soledad or Soledad's sister, and we don't know whether it's Soledad. So until the end, there is no denouement. So there is no exposition, there is no rising action, there is no climax, and there is no denouement. Because he's actually saying, meaning Jose de Lisa, if I will be allowed to interpret him, he's actually saying, why is the OFW situation so easy to define? It's all still all conflict ridden. Oh, the other thing that is that we have in a way introduced in the 90s as a kind of counter narrative is gay literature. And the group of J. Neil Garcia, Danton Rimoto, Danny Reyes, these were the people who did this ladlad. We know in ordinary parlance what it means, magladlad ka, you come out gay. Now, the thing that we lack now is an actual lesbian anthology. And I'm awaiting a lesbian anthology, a transvestite anthology, and bisexual anthology. So that's next. Now, Diliman Review has been there for more than 50 years. In fact, we have in 1952. So when I was the editor of that, I tried to make sure that there was no gap. There was a 5-year gap. So what I did is I went backwards. So this is the Diliman Review. And if you look at this, okay, these are done actually by our young artists. That's why I also look at the artistry of these people. This one is one of our iconic figures. He's supposed to be Zorro. It was by Mark Sullivan. And Don Mark Sullivan, this guy walks around campus. So you say Diliman, UP Diliman, you talk about him. But this is very important. But look at the one that's inside. It's actually the case for structure in 21st century fiction by Carlos Arius. The Asog culture in Ibalong. Speaking of the Subaltern by Noel Montinola. So, Moratilia, I'm sorry. Postmodern Inclinations, the poetry of Frank Simatu. So, Moratilia is based in UP, in our barangay. Grace Subido works on Frank Simatu and other Baguio writers. Eric Gamalinda's Empire of Memory as historiographic metafiction is very, very theoretical, but at the same time, it's done by a young Waldo Petralba in his 30s or 40s. Practical Arts by Jessel Duque. So it's done by a young writer, nonfiction. And then Starlet Sacrifice, a splat theory, a performance text by Yason Banal. So those are the examples of things we get. And look at this. This is by another artist, Amanda Legasto. And it says, in your shoes. And then this one is supposed to be the Oblation Run. But this guy, Mark, he wants to go to NASA. So what he did was he put his aspirations here. He made the Oblation Run. Oblation Run, which is a ritual every year, it's about naked men. He made them look like astronauts. And this one, of course, people from Diliman know that there has always been that rumor that the library, up there in the library, which used to be the College of Fine Arts, you have all these diwata. So this is the interpretation, the diwata, okay? or duende if you want to. And nobody can escape this. Now, this is called basic food group. But you know, these are street food. And it used to be turon lang. So everybody who comes here who is more like 60 years old, they look for the turon, not realizing that eto na, meron ng sisig, meron ng squid balls, meron ng lahat ng gusto mo sa mundo. Okay, and this of course is our lagoon with the stones. So, okay, by Roman Lito, Francia. So I'd like to show that our artists, yes, our artists were very active and they're still active now. Now, of course, we were learning from Francisco Aciliana, who was one of the first writers in English. But, and we celebrated his 100th birthday. So that book has been redone so that you have his new collection, no, by his wife, Emerenciana Aciliana, collection of Francisco Aciliana. And then the criticism about him done by Lydia Aciliana. Okay? Now, this is a group of people that who are working with me now. They're actually the millennials writers committed to the Bayan. So you have, for instance, the one of Body Hall by Alan Justo Pastrana. And, you know, Hemino Abad, one of our professor emeritus. He's our professor emeritus who said of Body Hall, he has five of the best poems in the entire collection of Philippine literature in English. That's coming from Hemino Abad, oh my God. And then this one, The Murmur of Asylum Poems by Ned Parfan, is also one of our young writers who talks about his experiences as a young man. And many of these collections are so dark. This is the millennials. These are the millennials talking. Then Looking for Polaris is by Dawn Marfil. Looking for Polaris, meaning the North Star, because in her life, she almost sinks down to a pit. But because she has the Polaris to look at the North Star, she can survive. And she was given a very beautiful introduction by Cristina Pantoja Hidalgo. So these are the millennial writers. And they're so, you know, don't say that the millennials don't care. They do care, and they're there, and they're available. Please look for them. And of course, see, Lord Luis de Vera has always been there. Now he has this cute, I wanted to say cute, but he's all serious. In other words, he has one-liners, he has speeches, he has essays in this collection. It is so small. And I hope you get it because Lourdes de Vera is one of those people who matagal na, antay na siya, meaning he's post-colonial already. So all of our societal practices, the ones I showed you, and texts can be used to construct our sense of country or nation or bayan. But what is a nation or a banwa or a bayan? And may I quote from Renan, a large aggregate of men, healthy in mind and warm of heart, creates the kind of moral consciousness which we can call a nation. So long as this moral consciousness gives proof of the strength by the sacrifice which demands the abdication of the individual, to the advantage of the community, it, meaning the nation, is legitimate and has the right to exist, says Renan. And what else? Although this is long, this is important. A nation is a soul, a spiritual principle, two things which in truth are but one. Constitute the soul or spiritual principle, one lies in the past and one is in the present. Now let me just put that together. In other words, we have a legacy that we are proud of. That's why we want to get together. And then we want to live as a community. That's where we're talking about the future. But the but here is that we have to be proud of our past. And yet, our own heroes say, the Philippine Revolution remains unfinished. Why? Because it was waged, and yet we did not get what we wanted. This is what Jose Rizal, our hero, Andres Bonifacio, another hero, and Artemio Ricarte said. They had envisioned and they had fought for an egalitarian society, which is where? Nowhere. There is this, you can get a DVD. Bonifacio ang unang pangulo at saka si General Luna. Both of them show what they did to create that nation, and yet what happened was that nothing. We did not get the society we wanted. In fact, they were both murdered. If you want the whole history of that, the one that became the movie, look at the work of Dr. Vivencio Jose. It's actually a book. And Dino Jose really researched on what happened to General Luna and what happened to us. Why did we fail during the revolution? Now, there are so many other things we can read. For instance, Virgilio Armario's own discussion of Jose Rizal and what he thought about the revolution. In my book, the one I edited with 35 Philippine Studies, How We Got Bayan St. Louis, I found this essay, according to Damon Woods, Bayan means one's location. Fine. We know that. It's a geographic location. But what we should add is that it is a relationship of people in that community. And it means that you're not only talking about your location, you're also talking about yourself as part of a group. Now, this word Bayan will continue, and at present, it can be used to refer to different communities, and it will include all of our ethno-linguistic groups. And in the future, this Bayan can include, through diasporic studies, the Filipinos who are in Canada, Australia, everywhere in the world, because they are now fighting for what they say is called binary nationalisms. So, postcolonial strategies for writers, everybody, in other words, should be about creating a new social formation and a new identity so that we can create a nation. We suggest that we utilize the different postcolonial strategies to recuperate, re-semanticize our different languages, practices, and texts, within which we produce or study or teach everything that has to do with our construction of Filipinohood. I say Filipinohood because there is no essential Filipino. We become Filipinos in the same manner that there is no such thing as what is a Bayan. No, we create the Bayan. Let's see. So Bayan or mother country was always the Filipino writer's first muse. That is Heminoban, but we can say Bayan or country has always been our muse. Okay, so you can look at Heminoban's statement on that. That's the reason why we call Inang Bayan. There are so many songs about Inang Bayan. The river, it used to be just one river in Manila. Now you can say of the entire Filipinas, we can call it Inang Bayan. So, I will just give you an example of, we need visionaries. And where they make ikat ni Tibulis, this tape shows us that you have to have a visionary in order to make the ikat. And that ikat becomes your vision of what the future shall be. So it's the same thing with us. We need visionaries who will be dream weavers. We should dream weave our Bayan. This one by Amanda Legasto, it tells us what we should be doing as teachers. That kid, this is an award-winning piece, by the way, and became the cover of my Metrobank book, which included all the essays of those who won for the Search for Outstanding Teachers about their experiences in trying to educate people so that we become free people. This one is the price of education. And what does it mean? Here's this little kid. He's so burdened by his apple. And the apple is education. So in other words, the education is not doing anything for him. let's see the others. Here, the perspective, we saw that. It's a perspective in my shoes, and it's still nothing. It's just what? The same universe. Okay, this one is, well, if we are not careful, because if you will notice, the title is called Meat. If we are not careful about what we do with our environment, and especially with the animals in our environment, the artist, Don Sullivan, says, okay, you will become meat. Baliktaran na lang. This one is actually Filipino Gothic. It's an appropriation of American Gothic. In American Gothic, you have a cathedral at the back and you have two people stalwarts trying to defend. Yung parang born again. So in a way, it is a, supposedly, do not be too hard. It is a critique of being too absolute. But you know, and you know, part of the joke is that this has become appropriated and sold to a eatery in near UP Diliman, pang steak. Oh, ayan. Yan ang tinatawag na yun. This is an example of a kind of CD based on a television interview. It's called Nonsense because it is being it was hosted by a nun, Sister Mary John, and the topic was women in history, and it had Professor Mila Guerrero, it had Professor Fe Mangahas, and it had me, Legasto. Okay, and this is the other books that you can see, Waiting for Makiling and Feminista on Women. And this book, Filipiniana Reader, contains again a series of materials from different Filipinists. And I hope you can get it. It became the basis for the first open new course on cultural studies, Filipiniana online. Filipiniana is the word we use for Philippine material. So many contributors were also from abroad. And then it became the basis of the first web course by the UP Open University. It became eventually Cultural Studies 250. Filipiniana Online is the companion reader. Okay, these are the women we owe for being so forward before. This is Amelia La Peña Bonifacio, Professor Emeritus, and she was the author of Seditious Tagalog's Playwrights, Early American Occupation. And the other one was Doreen Fernandez, author of Palabas. So it's about Philippine theater. Yes. And of course, the reason I put that there and the reason why we get it is because it's about China. China is just there. And it tells us that they were the Chinese built the wall. So that means they're so determined. They were fighting the Mughals. But there is another part of the China which I was there. 1990s, the Chinese from the rural areas went to the cities. But then, that's what they showed, the difficulties of competing with China, because we try to have adequate wages. I don't know what happens in China. So, let's do it. It's a favorite of our friend from the Department of Medicine before. Doctor, let's do it, he says. And then I would say, because we are UP, nowhere to go but up.